actually, when I never ever thought, you know, I would have to write his biography, because Kasturiji wrote first four volumes, and next quarter century nobody attempted writing his biography. And in 2003, you know, I was prompted, and Baba blessed me to write his biography. And he guided me also to gather material.
For more than 50 years, a never-ending reflection of selfless love. Mudnahalli's Narasimhamurti. No salary has ever played a role in his life. All needs were supplied by holy man Sri Satya Sai Baba without request. And after Baba left his body, Murti describes how he receives to this day Sai Baba's emphatic, detailed, and specific direction.
Yeah. Then when after the Mahasamadhi, when Baba came to you.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. July 10th.
July 10th.
He said, now onwards, you know, I will use Satya Sai Anandam. But here I want to give a clarification. It does not mean that he is not there elsewhere.
See, Prashanti, for example.
Yeah, if I present, yeah, anywhere. Yeah. He is everywhere and he is in every home where he is loved.
University warden, teacher, author, devotee, leader. Narasimhamurti is a man who carries out the greatest and smallest requests of Sai Baba's will. Murti is the author of the final volumes of Satyam Shivam Sundaram, the life story of Bhagavan Sri Satya Sai Baba, from 1986 onward. And Murti has also recorded his own galvanizing autobiography, Sri Satya Sai Divya Kripa Spraya, Under the Umbrella of Divine Grace of Sri Satya Sai.
Now here I want to tell you something which Swami has told me. It is true that I declared to the world that I would be in this Satya Sai Baba form for 96 years. I left when I was 85, but I will be in this subtle body till I am 96.
So and there's continue, a time frame on this.
And subtle. Continue to do what I did. Mm. And the only proof is things are happening.
Oh, they are.
Things are happening.
This account describes how Narasimhamurti's life has been fashioned for service to others. Even after 70 years of age, Baba has this most obedient devotee performing tasks impossible for the rest of us. The love and service described here depicts a recipe for sainthood. Welcome to Sojourns. This interview was recorded in January 2013 on the sprawling campus in Mudnahalli, India, of the Sri Satya Sai University and lower schools.
Narasimhamurti.
Yes, please.
Anna, big brother.
Anna, big brother. That's how younger people call me.
Yes. It is such a pleasure to be able to talk with you after so many years. I remember seeing you years ago at Vrindavan.
Yes.
And I was just there this morning listening to the world's most beautiful bhajans on Sunday morning. I want to ask you before I get into anything else, how you came to Swami, when you knew you were on a deep spiritual path?
Actually, first time I met Bhagwan when I was only 19 years old, way back in 1964.
You met him then?
Yeah, 1964 at Puttaparthi. And just before that, a deep spiritual quest had started in me. Because I was hunted by two questions which generally do not occur to young people. One was the question of death. If every man is going to die, what is the use of this life? See, that question had become an obsession with me. That was much before I came to Bhagavan Baba, maybe a year before.
And where did that come from? I've never heard anybody say they've had such a profound interest in the purpose of life.
Yeah, I don't know. The second is, who placed me in this vast universe? You know, nights, you know, the starry skies would scare me. And these were questions which I couldn't ask anybody. I tried to ask some people about whom I thought they can guide me, but they thought, you know, I had gone off my mind. So I just kept quiet. At the same time, I had lost faith in God. See, as a child, my parents were thieves. They were very religious people, brought me up on a spiritual diet. As a young boy, I had great devotion. Why I say I had great devotion to God when I was a young child and boy was, whenever I heard the stories of great saints, you know, I would cry. That would happen very spontaneously. remembering that, I would say that I had a great devotion to God. Mm-hmm. But somewhere when I was studying in the college, it so happened that was the fashion those days. The Marxist ideas were spreading very fast. That was in the early 60s in India, especially college students. The Marxist ideas were spreading. And with that, I thought I became an atheist, but most importantly, I lost faith in God. I used to get very searching doubts whether God is really there or not. See, that was there. So that was a kind of question. That was the time when these two problems started haunting me. And it became an obsession. So I lost interest in life.
At such a young age.
Yeah, 18 years
when
old.
When most people have everything to
do. Yeah, even I had everything. But certainly, you know, these questions became so serious for me. I wanted to find answers. Is there anything beyond death? And why am I placed in this universe? So these two questions.
So what happened?
And then, you know, I had one friend. In fact, actually this morning he had come here. After a long time we met. He was a devotee of Ramakrishna Paramahansa and Vivekananda. So we used to have very long discussions on whether God exists or not. Of course, the arguments were never conclusive, because I couldn't prove to him that God doesn't exist, and he couldn't prove to me that God exists. So that's how things were happening. Then suddenly one night, you know, it became so unbearable for me, and somebody had left a magazine with a Jesus Christ on the cover page on my table. It was quite, late in the night. Maybe it could be 2 a.m.
Okay.
In the morning. I just got up. I was feeling very perturbed. I looked at that photograph and broke down.
Really?
And prayed to God. Prayed to God.
So that touched you. That provoked you.
Yeah, that's how it happened. I prayed to God. God, if you really exist, I am also your son like Jesus. Why do you forsake me? That is a kind of, from depth, I got that, prayer. And I was crying for a long time and slept off. Morning, I woke up with firm faith in God. God exists.
That came to me. Even though you were asleep at the time, it came.
Yeah, it came. That faith came. When I got up, I was so very happy. And felt, when did I feel that I didn't believe in God? That was the question which was occurring to me. Complete faith. But my concept of God at that point of time was cosmic power, which has created this universe and running this universe. I couldn't somehow believe that, you know, God could be in the human form or any particular form.
It was just an invisible energy as far as you
can. Exactly. Yeah. Energy. Cosmic energy. Mm-hmm. Energy, conscious energy. Not, unconscious energy. It is conscious energy who responds to anything that happens in the universe. That kind of faith I had when I woke up, but I was very happy. At that time, this friend, gave me some books on Ramakrishna Paramahansa and Vivekananda. Mm-hmm. So that really led me to the path. Then I started praying to God. Especially I prayed to Ramakrishna Paramahansa once actually. You were there 100 years before to guide young people like us. Today, who is there? If there is anybody of your kind on earth today, please lead me to him. See, that's what I prayed. Within three months, I was led to Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba.
And how were you led to him?
Yeah.
What was it that led you to him?
I tell you. See, my mentor, Madiyal Narayan Bhatt, whom all of us called Anna. Mm-hmm. See, my younger brothers called me Anna, but all of us called him Anna. And he came into my life because I was studying in Bangalore Engineering College at that time. And he was, gathering young people who are interested in nation, society, service, and talking to them. And first time, he told me about Bhagwan Sri Sat Sai Baba. And he said, if you are interested, I will take you to him. And I also pray that he will grant you an interview. That's what he said. Those days, 64, it was quite easy, A few hundred people would be around in Prashant Nilayam at any point of time.
So that was the first time you really heard of his name. Probably the first time you ever saw a photograph of him?
No. Actually, by chance I had encountered a book on Baba written by someone, I don't remember at that point of time. Earlier, I had known that. But you know, at that time, a lot of mispropaganda was happening in the newspapers here, southern India, about Baba. Mm-hmm. So I thought, you know, he was a fraud. That's what I thought. But when my mentor told me, I will take you to him, I said, yes, let's go.
You know, I felt the same way. I was in South America working for the Peace Corps from America.
Yeah.
And in 1968, saw his picture for the first time in a news magazine. Mm. And I felt the same way.
Yeah.
Boy, did I do an about face.
Exactly.
But it took time for
Exactly. The same way. That's it.
So then when your prayers were answered, found a guide, found a teacher.
Yeah.
Were you quick to embrace him, or did it come the slow way as it does for some of us?
No, it was almost immediate. As soon as I saw Baba in Puttaparthi for the first time, there was some stirring inside me. And when he called me for interview, I broke down. I couldn't really, you know, I was not in my real senses that way. And for about 15 minutes, I broke down. Baba was very kind and patient to wait for me. And then he spoke the first words to me. What he said is, you should have come long time back. You have come late. But you are worrying about your future. Don't worry about your future. Your future is safe in Swami's hands. That's what he said, first words. So that gave me instant faith. But not that my faith settled down immediately after that. I had to go through really almost 1 year of very excruciating trauma in my mind, whether I am believing the wrong person, whether I am being misled, this kind of question. Because
so you still had one more period where doubt crept in.
Yeah, after 1 month.
After one month.
The point, what attracted me to Swami at that point of time was, people, you know, who knew Baba at that time or who didn't know about Baba at that time were telling me, see, Sai Baba is a rich man's God.
Mm-hmm.
He will talk only to rich people, people in position, authority.
And of course, you were a rich man with lots of authority.
No, I was not. I was not. At that time, I was a pauper. I didn't have education. I didn't have position. But Baba called me and spoke to me with so much love, as if, you know, he was a long-lost friend or what. See, that attracted me. In spite of doubt in my mind, I was a doubting Thomas, according to Swami himself.
Once he called me also,
the same thing.
We have a lot in common.
Lot of doubting Thomases around. Yes. And, you know, that love, affection attracted me. That's why every month I started going. And every month he was speaking to me, calling me for an interview. I was just a boy of 19 years at that time.
Why did he shower so much attention, so much favor?
Because he thought, I think, I would be useful as a warden for a lifetime.
And you became a warden
for his students. For his students.
And what he thought was correct.
Probably, you know, probably he thought, more importantly, now I know, the whole thing was a master plan. Now I very well know. The whole thing was a master plan in retrospect. And the last visit of Bhagavan Baba to this place on 14th of February 2009, on the Valentine's Day, he materialized this ring and put it on my finger.
Well, I can't believe he didn't materialize that 40 years ago for you. It's a beautiful ring.
I'll come to that.
Okay.
Then he told me at that point of time, Mr. Nara, he called me on the stage and materialized. It is not that. See, I had enough
time. Called you on the stage.
Stage, no. I was on the stage along with Baba. Mm-hmm. I thought I had to translate his, you know, Telugu discourse into English because there were a lot of people who didn't know Telugu. I was just sitting behind him. We had a lot of time before that inside the room. I was all alone with him for a long time, but he didn't do that. But when he started speaking, of course, he didn't give me any attention. Therefore, I sat down because I thought he didn't want any translation. And suddenly he called me Narasimhamurthy.
English.
Narasimhamurthy. And, you know, he materialized this ring and put it on my finger and then said in public, Narasimhamurthy, you have to come to Muddinalli. You have some work to do here. Yes.
You had to come here?
Yeah. I will tell you why.
That's what I think now.
Confusing because, you know, Baba came here in 1983, 7th of August, and took me from here to Puttaparthi to make me warden in the university at that point of time. Till 83, since the inception of this particular campus. It was a school at that time. 1973, we started the school and offered the school to Bhagwan in 1978, which he took over. And he was coming here quite often after that. In 1983, when he came here on a visit on 7th of August 1983, he asked me, are you ready to come with me? I said, yes. Then Swami said, not for a ride. Can you come and stay with me there and work, serve me? I said, Swami, that's what I want. And how much time would you require to pack up? I said, 30 minutes. he was surprised. I mean, he looked surprised. So that day, Baba took me to Puttaparthi, made me warden there. And then I was warden of the university hostel for 17 plus 12.
This
29 years.
Vrindavan or
Puttaparthi? First in Puttaparthi, okay. 6 years. Then Swami wanted me to go to Vrindavan. I was in Vrindavan for 22 to 23 years.
So he really put you away for a long time.
Yeah, a very long time. I mean, lifetime warden is difficult to find, especially in Sathya Sai University.
No more a warden.
No.
You're warden emeritus.
Yeah, warden emeritus. And I was in Vrindavan when Baba was about to visit this place for doing groundbreaking ceremony for the university here, which he had announced on the previous birthday.
Three or four years ago.
Yeah. That was 2008 birthday.
Okay.
But nobody expected. He announced that I want to have a university campus in Muddenhalli.
So it's totally off the radar. Nobody knew.
Nobody. I also didn't know. People are looking at me thinking that maybe Baba had discussed it with me. I was also having a question. So that's how it was. I was in Vrindavan, but Swami sent word to me through three or four people. I had to be present here for that occasion.
Mm-hmm.
So I came here, and this is what Baba did. You have work to do in Muddenhalli. But after that, I asked Baba, when I have to go there, I will tell you. But, just maybe a month before he left the body in, 2011, April 24th, he gave me a hint. You have to go to Muddenhalli. So then Baba got admitted to hospital. Therefore, I was in Prashantalim all those days. And after that, because it was Swami's command, I moved here on 18th of May to Muddenhalli.
Okay, this was before he left his body.
Yeah. Then I was wondering what work I had to do here and waiting for it. I thought it was university work, but Swami very clearly indicated that I had to establish more schools, Sathya Sai schools, in this state of Karnataka.
So he wasn't referring to this one. It was already established. He was referring to future schools. I think there's like 30 districts in this state, correct?
Exactly.
Karnataka.
Exactly.
And so he wanted you to start thinking about establishing schools everywhere.
Exactly.
Just in the state of Karnataka.
Exactly. Okay. That's what he has said. But right now he's guiding me to go to a place outside Karnataka, which I have not told anybody. Even Shiva is looking at me with surprise.
So Baba, I'm getting ahead of myself here because Baba obviously guides you and talks to you all the time. So making news here now.
Not all the time. Whenever he wants. Even earlier it was like that. Whenever I want, I couldn't go to him and talk to him. Whenever he wanted to talk to me, he would talk to me. Even earlier when he was in the physical body. And even now it is so.
Before we get on to that story, because I'd love to hear where he's guiding you to outside of Karnataka, and we'll do that in a minute. But first, one of the famous guidances that you're known for with Baba was following his Mahasamadhi. When he talked about this place as his home, could you, for the benefit of the Sai Baba devotees around the world who don't hear all the stories here because they're not here, could you briefly review that story?
See, that was on 10th July. 15th July was Guru Purnima, 2011. And 10th July, first time Bhagwan, I saw him. I wrote was a dream.
Wait a minute. You said you saw him.
I saw him in a dream.
You saw him in a dream, okay.
A dream, yes. And that was the time he told me that on the Guru Purnima day, he will come to Sathya Sai Anandam, which was newly built for him.
Okay.
Before that, he used to stay in Premdeep, which is another mandir, at the foot of the hill, actually. And he said, now I am going there.
Here at Muddenhalli?
At Muddenhalli, we have in fact three mandirs.
Okay.
One is what we call as the old mandir, where he visited 18 times.
He He appeared. He came 18
times. He came physically. Came 18 times, he was using that old mandir,
okay,
which they will show you tomorrow.
Okay.
And then after that, we built a new mandir at the foot of the hill. That, you know, there Swami visited 11 times.
Okay.
And last time when he came, he did the groundbreaking ceremony for another mandir on hilltop, which is now named Sri Satya Sai Anandam.
And I understand that he never visited that.
He never visited that because he came only for Bhumi Puja, our groundbreaking ceremony. And several times Baba was asking me when it was being constructed, what is the stage at which it is, and whether the clock tower is coming up well. Every time I said, Swami, it's going well, but why not you come? He said, I'll come. But he never came physically.
Was the clock tower his idea or your idea?
It was clock tower was his idea.
Okay. So yes. All along there was plans for a clock tower.
Yeah, clock tower was his idea. In fact, the architects had designed it a little shorter. Swami wanted it that high as it is now.
So let's not lose where we are in this story here.
Yeah.
Then when after the Mahasamadhi, when Baba came to you.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. July 10th.
July 10th.
He said, now onwards, you know, I will use Satya Sai Anandam. But here I want to give a clarification. It does not mean that he is not there elsewhere.
See, Prashanti, for example.
Yeah, if I present, yeah, anywhere for that.
He's in Cleveland, Ohio.
He's everywhere.
Fort Walton Beach, Florida.
Yeah, he's everywhere and he's in every home where he is loved.
So what did he mean by that?
He said, see, earlier he was in the Prem Deep Mandir, which he visited.
Yes.
He said, I will be in Satya Sai Anandam. He is omnipresent. He is everywhere. It doesn't mean that he stays only in Satya Sai Anandam in Mudrali and not elsewhere. I want to give that clarification, which people generally, you know, get confused about.
Well, I understand, and that's clarified, but he must have meant something by that.
Definitely, because he gave all the details, like, you know, the cot you have, which you have put in this old mandir, Premdeep, is too high for me. Mm-hmm. Make it short. And move all my personal belongings from this Prem Deep old mandir to Satya Sai Anandam.
And all this guidance came after his body.
All this guidance came. And one thing, you know, he told me was that on that day of Guru Purnima, we had to distribute clothes to all the 1,000 students here.
New clothes, white clothes.
I was just wondering, you know, where do I get, so much money for this?
Swami, are you going to make these clothes for me?
Then it happened, you know, next morning, of course, so much other guidance also he gave me there. Then, you know, a lot of it is very personal. And then, you know, next morning, 11 o'clock, one of our old students, alumnus, comes into my room and says, I have brought 1,000 pairs of clothes for the students.
Really?
Yes. And I just asked him, how did you get this? He said, Swami prompted me. That's all he said.
After he prompted you to
get. Next time when he came, I asked him, how did Baba communicate to you that you have to get this 1,000 pairs? Then he said, the same way he communicates with you. That's what he said.
And you're not going to tell us about that.
That's what it was. So that confirmed that there was some substance in that, guidance of Swami.
Of course it would confirm
and
that.
And we had a very nice function on 15th
of July. But why does he say things like, this will be my home?
Maybe, you know, see, there are a lot of people who are spiritual aspirants in this place, who are totally dedicated to Bhagavan's service, like, you know, Catholic priests. Mm-hmm. We do have about 40 people.
You do?
Yeah. People without family encumbrances, like myself. Mm-hmm. And there are youngsters like our Siva Subramaniam also. And maybe he loves them. And maybe he thought, you know, that would give us a great confidence and a sense of, assurance it was. Probably, because I do believe, and also he asked us that he should be served food, you know, like he was there in physical form.
So do you serve him food?
We. And in fact, he selected two students from university at that point of time. He gave the names.
After he died, after he left.
This happened on 10th July.
Okay.
10th and 11th July.
He gave you two names.
Two names of students who should serve him. So we selected those two boys. And, they have been serving, of course, assisted by some of our teachers, who loves Swami.
Let me ask you a silly question.
Yeah.
Does he eat the food?
Sometimes there are signs. There are signs there are signs. See, because those boys who serve food, one day came and showed me some, you know, long hair, you know, on the plate. Mm-hmm. So he said, how did this come here? It could be Baba's. Mm-hmm. The point here is, I would like to tell you here, this clarification is very much required for devotees. Baba is not in the physical body now. Physical body is gone once for all. He is in the subtle body.
Once and for all.
Once and for all. This is my understanding as per what he has told me.
But he is present to us in the subtle body.
Yeah, subtle body. Mm-hmm. Subtle body.
We can't see
yeah,
it.
You can,
it.
Yeah, you can see him. Like this, I tell you how it is. Subtle body interacts with your subtle body in your dream.
In your dream.
Yeah, dream. Or he can interact with you in meditation. If you have achieved enough expertise to have that kind of focus.
So if you're deeply enough into your silence.
Yeah, deeply in meditation, you know, you are in the subtle body. See, we are really the subtle body and the causal body. Physical body is only our dress. See, this is what Baba was telling us. That is the truth also. Mm-hmm. And he is in the subtle body only. And he appears in the meditation, deep meditations, visions. So there also he can guide you. Therefore, when we say that Baba eats food, it is not physical food.
I see.
He takes the subtle part of the food. See, all this is very difficult to understand for normal lot of
people.
It's very
helpful, the way you're explaining it. Thank you for explaining it this way.
Yeah, yeah. See, it is like this. See, it is like this. No, I mean, you know, suppose you keep a tumbler of water in front of him. It is not that, you know, there'll be, you know, when he drinks water, there'll be some less quantity of water in the tumbler. He takes the subtle part of water because all spiritual masters have told us any form, object, lifeless object or an animal or a bird or an insect or human beings, all of them have three forms. That's why Baba said, you are not one but three. You know that. Mm-hmm. One is what you think you are is the body.
What others think
you are is the mind, subtle body. What you really are
is Atma.
So therefore, everything has three forms actually. Mm-hmm. Look at this chair. There is a subtle form for this. Mm-hmm. This is what every master has said. When you say that he eats food, it eats the subtle form of the food because it is a subtle body. Mm-hmm. See, that is how it is. And we also have the very sacred custom of offering food in our temples to gods.
Sure.
You know, we offer naivedyam, it is called. In every temple they offer. And it is not that, you know, God eats that food physically, but the subtle form of that food is consumed by God because he is in the subtle form.
So that's really sort of a euphemism or a manner of speaking when he says this is his home. Obviously, every place in existence is
exactly.
his home.
Yes.
But he has a fondness for this place because of his many visits here.
Yeah, exactly.
And because of the boys he's chosen to feed him.
Exactly.
And the three mandirs here.
Exactly.
And because of you, I'm not saying that you're special, but I am saying there has to be a reason for his guidance to you that's so frequent.
Yeah, even earlier, see, I was with Bhagavan for 47 years. Mm-hmm. And first time when he guided me, I was only 19 years old, as I told you.
Yeah.
After that.
1963?
1964. 64. And I've done just what he has told me all these years.
Totally loyal.
Yes, totally. Because, see, he told me, you know, you have to go to this particular place. I went. And then he said, you have to move to another place. I moved. And then he told me most important thing in my life was dedicating my life for spiritual aspiration and service, which he blessed. He said, don't get married. So I followed it. Therefore, everything I followed. Therefore, it is no surprise to me that he is guiding me even today. Because I was totally dependent on him for everything. And to be very frank with you, at this point of time, I never received any salary anywhere in my life.
How did you live?
I sustained on what he gave me physically. And just what he gave me.
And you worked full-time, 7 days a week, no doubt.
Yeah.
Endlessly for the boys, for the university, for the ashram.
Yes. Yes, I always did what he wanted me to do, and he looked after all my needs, material needs, spiritual needs.
So you don't have many attachments, because I'm sure, without getting any salary, he provided
everything to me, and I just depended on him for everything, but he never failed me. So never failed me. One particular incident which is so touching, I would like to tell you at this point of time. That was almost in 2010, I think. It was 2010, 1 year before Bhagwan passed away. And it was my birthday. I was in Vrindavan. And my deputy warden, Dr. Ravi Kumar, who is presently warden in Vrindavan, was in Puttaparthi. Baba called him inside the interview. And I had not told anybody that was my birthday, because nobody knows when is my birthday, because I never disclosed it, because living among students, if you announce your birthday, it's a very difficult thing on the birthday for you. So even now, nobody knows when exactly is my birthday. Bhagwan told him, today is his birthday. And you know, that time Baba was not able to write, but himself wrote on a cover, envelope, you know, which was having money in that. He wrote to Dear Narasimha Murthy, from your Sai Ma.
Sai Ma, he called himself.
And I could see that handwriting. Today I have preserved it as a great treasure in my life.
Of course.
Because it is not steady hand.
And
you can
see. And you said because he could not write, this is when he didn't have motor skills to write with a
physical hand.
But he wrote this anyway.
Yeah. And he said, and gave it to Ravi Kumar and told him, give it to him.
And had money on the inside?
Yeah, a lot of money. Though I never drew any salary.
So your all my life gave you a real nice birthday present.
Yeah, Sai Ma sustained me. And all my life, I have lived like a prince.
A prince?
I never lacked anything. Yes, yes, yes.
That's because you're the model of non-attachment. Yeah. Non-attachment. I mean, you provided for her with chapatis and white clothes, and you have a roof over your head.
Yes,
beyond that, there's very little that you need or want, apparently.
Yeah, exactly. But whatever I needed at any point of time, he always gave me without my asking. I mean, in fact, I never asked for anything. See, that is the other side. I have never asked him. He has told me any number of times, Narasimha Murthy, if you want something, you ask me, I will give. But all my life, I practiced this principle. I never asked him anything. Without being asked, he gave me always everything.
But you're a man of tremendous power. I use that term.
Faith.
Faith, authority, leadership skills. So I can't imagine how inestimable it must be for the students who have been here, for the graduates that you've nurtured throughout the years, for the Sevadals, for the other administrative workers, to know your story, know that you've never asked for anything, and know that even in your position of influence, you've always been given everything you need.
Yeah, always.
And never
always.
Needed more, never wanted
Never more. Needed more. Suppose I didn't get anything, I thought I don't need it. I thought and believed I don't need it. He always gave me what I needed. Jeez. Exactly, that's the thing.
Is it? We're going to jump around just a little bit because we have limited time and I have so many interesting areas I'd like to just briefly touch upon. You've made it clear to me that Baba comes to you and guides you often.
Yeah.
I'm not interested so much in how he comes to you. But
he can do it in 101 ways, as you said.
Yeah, but can you share with us a little more about what he, let's just say in the last month or so, the last week or so, how he guides you?
So the point is, right now he has entrusted to me the job of expansion of his educational mission.
Which you're working on.
Yes. Now, we have five new school projects on hand.
For Karnataka.
In Karnataka. And two have already started working. We do have about 1,000 students in our institutions right now. This particular trust, which was formed as per guidance from Baba, Sri Satya Sai Saraswati Education Trust, for which all the members are our alumni. Mm-hmm. 1 year back it was founded. Now within 1 year, we have two schools running already and three new school projects, out of which two will start next June.
That's a phenomenal pace.
Yeah, and it is a lot of work for me. A lot of work. So I rarely stay in Mudanahalli. All the time, you know, I'm hopping from place to place and setting up the schools, construction. And one thing, you know, which may be of great joy for the devotees is, when he told me on 27th of August, 4 months after he left the body, he told me that it is my sankalpa to start a school in a place called Gulbarga.
And where is that?
Gulbarga is 700 kilometers from here.
It's not in town. Karnataka.
No, it is in northern Karnataka. Northern Karnataka.
Okay.
Which I had never gone. Never gone.
So he's giving you the precise location.
Yeah. What he told me was this. I have chosen a land, 50 acres in extent, and it is enclosed by two roads, one north-south and one east-west, and it is sloping towards the east. This is what all he told me. Then he told me to go to Gulbarga on September 6th. 27th August, he told me.
Is this a small village or a big town?
Oh, no, it's a huge place.
Oh, is it? Okay.
It's a huge place. It's a Gulbarga is not a town. It's a district.
It's a district.
District, very huge district.
Okay.
And when I went, you know, some of my friends joined me because they were also interested in this mad venture.
You had to find this place.
Yeah, I had to find the place. So we went round and round and we saw about 20 to 25 places. And finally, I thought this was the place because it matched the specification given by Baba.
Many places have an east-west road and a north-south road intersecting.
Yeah, it is.
On
it
a slope.
Is. But at that time, whenever I got a doubt, I got Baba's guidance.
Okay.
He confirmed that was the place.
Was it for sale?
Yes, it was for sale. 45 acres of land.
And he said we 50, purchased. So it was
yeah,
perfect.
Yeah, we purchased. We purchased. And how the money came, somebody came and gave me, this is for the land.
For the land.
Yes.
They knew.
I tell you.
They were guided.
Yes. No, here I want to tell you something very interesting.
Or you're going to tell me that we're all guided to help one another. At the same time, they're guided to be of service to us.
Exactly. September 6th, first time I went to Gulbarga, I had requested for a meeting of the devotees, Baba's devotees, and our alumni in that place. And Baba had told me to make three announcements. The first was, the Bhumi Puja, a groundbreaking ceremony, would take place before that birthday in 2011. Second, next June 2012, school would start. And thirdly, the completed building would be inaugurated before the next birthday. All three happened. All three happened. I tell you the very important thing
this
is.
This just boggles my mind that Swami tells you with such specificity.
Yes.
And these things actually come to pass.
Yes.
And he's just smiling over your shoulder as if people see it as a mystery that can't be figured out.
In fact,
it is a mystery. It's a puzzle.
Yeah.
It's a puzzle.
Yeah.
How can this person who had the money for the land have any way of knowing how specific Baba's instructions were to you to find this land, someplace you had never been before, and then you go and you find it, and this person comes forth with the money to buy the land.
Yeah.
And that's probably how all these projects are working out.
And he also gave the plan for that building, which is pentagonal in shape. It's a pentagon.
What's the significance of the pentagon shape?
Baba
because I've seen that more than once here.
Yeah, he told me that each side represents one value, Satya, Dharma, Shanti, Prema, and Ahimsa, five sides.
So his handprint is in everything that's done.
Exactly. So that was a new school project, which was inaugurated on November 19th by Sri Indulal Shahji, who came from Mumbai and inaugurated that campus.
Amazing.
So it's a very busy time for me. What I thought, when I came to Muddinahalli, I thought I had served Swami enough. And had being a warden in Swami's hostels for so long, you know, is a real job. I thought I would come here and spend my time in contemplation, meditation, or writing.
Like a monk.
Like a monk and guiding people who come to me for spiritual guidance. And that's what I thought. But now, you know, he has really put me on a, very busy schedule.
You better hope that Sai Baba gives you another 40 to 50 years to do all these projects.
Yeah, I think he has told me that also. I think unless he finishes his projects, he won't leave me also.
So do you think he's having you do all this work with 30 districts and 30 schools, plus the one you mentioned out of the district, as a model, as a template for other people to practice with other states in India and maybe beyond India?
Definitely. It's always so. See, Bhagwan, he founded a few hospitals. It doesn't mean those few hospitals can serve the whole world.
Yeah.
He's setting an ideal, which is blended with compassion and love for everyone.
I just interviewed Dr. Devi Prasad Shetty yesterday, the world's largest hospital, where the cardiothoracic surgeries are being brought down. Currently they're not here, but they're on their way down to $800 for those who can afford to pay it, and free for those who can't, following right after Baba's mention.
Exactly.
So you're doing the template that others will be able to look to see how successful they can be.
Yeah.
Started inauspiciously, inexpensively, but very profoundly, serving the young people in need, and how this can be done to help teach the human values in other districts, yeah, in any country, not just any,
yes,
state.
Yes, it is definitely not only for Karnataka, not only for India. It is for everybody who is a follower of Baba and who would like to serve his cause or his mission.
I would like to know everything I could.
But here, you know, I would like to tell you something.
Yes, please do.
See, today the real crisis in the world, not only in India, is the crisis of bankruptcy of spiritual and moral values.
Not financial bankruptcy.
Yes. And Baba always believed it is young children, you know, who can be, who are so pure in their hearts, who could be molded as a new kind of citizens of the world.
Mm.
He had lost hope of elder people like us because, you know, we don't change. And pure-hearted young people, and it was Baba, you know, who inspired my mentor to say, there are no bad children, there are only bad parents and bad teachers. Yes.
Oh, that's a very big...
Yes, that is the fact. The children are very pure. If you can get hold of a few teachers who are having some kind of purity, it is easy to mold them. See, that is why this educational mission of Baba is most important, and that is the only way of salvation for mankind. There is no other way. There is no other way. We have to create a new set of young citizens out of these children who come to our schools. Mm-hmm. For example, this particular school, you know, we can take about 200 boys every year, newly.
Mm-hmm.
We get more than 3,000 applications.
Oh my goodness.
What it means, 2,800 parents, mm-hmm, who bring their children, mold my son on the lines of Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba's educational philosophy, we are asking them get lost. See, that's a tragedy, according to me. It's a great tragedy. Maybe Baba is, you know, now founding these schools to give opportunity to everybody, every child who wants to study in his institutions. See, that's what it is.
Mm. I understand if people want to know more about how Swami's been an influence globally and one-to-one, all they need to do is look up the three volumes on Swami's life, which you have written.
Yeah.
And did he help you in the form, or did he help you through his guidance otherwise?
Yeah. Actually, when I never ever thought, you know, I would have to write his biography, because Kasturiji, mm-hmm, wrote first four volumes,
yeah,
and next quarter century, nobody attempted writing his biography. The last, biography was published in 1980,
mm-hmm,
fourth volume. Fifth volume came out in 2005. And in 2003, you know, I was prompted and Baba blessed me to write his biography. And he guided me also to gather material.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever I gathered material, sometimes I had the opportunity to verify its authenticity. And I talked to those people whom I knew well. I didn't talk to everybody, because a lot of people tell a lot of stories. You know, I wanted authenticity should be there. Therefore, I verified it from Bhagwan. And photographs, I collected hundreds of photographs, out of which he selected photographs for the book. The cover page was selected by him. The cover photo was selected for all the three volumes. And that's how it happened, yes.
Mm. Do you believe Baba guides many of us the same way as he's guiding you, or just a few of us?
He must be guiding a lot of people all around, because you know that a lot of new hospitals are also coming up.
I heard about that.
Yes.
At least
and new water project also.
New water project?
Yes, in Andhra Pradesh, Adilabad district.
So even after his Mahasamadhi,
yes,
these projects continue.
Yes, yes. Now here I want to tell you something which Swami has told me. It is true that I declared to the world that I would be in this Satya Sai Baba form for 96 years. I left when I was 85, but I will be in this subtle body till I am 96.
So
and
there's
continue
a time frame on the
and subtle. Continue to do what I did.
Mm.
And the only proof is things are happening.
Oh, they are.
Things are happening. See, this is what one of my friends in Prashanthinilayam, who is in a good position in Prashanthinilayam, tells me. So it's very difficult to believe what you say, but one thing I believe, whatever Baba is telling you is happening, therefore I have to believe.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I agree.
And because you go to Gulbarga, I would love you to go to Gulbarga, where we have started.
700 kilometers away, right?
Yeah, 700 kilometers away. But there is an airport called Hyderabad, which is 200 kilometers away.
Well, we're going to Hyderabad.
And you can go there and look at that majestic building. I tell you very honestly, I confess I didn't build it. Then who built it?
Is this the building on the 45 acres of land? Or is this
It is on the 45 acres of land.
So the land was donated, 45 acres, you found the right place.
Yeah.
And is the school open yet?
Yeah, school opened in June.
This is one of the three or four or five that's open already.
Yes, it's already 123 students are there, and 110 boys in the hostel, and 13 coming from local villages. Free education. We don't charge a single paisa for education, which is a matter of great amazement and surprise for people. How do you run this school? He's running it.
People tell me.
And the building is worth, the building investment on that campus, including land, is more than 10 crore rupees.
I have seen pictures of it just this afternoon.
Beautiful pictures. Yes.
Nobody thinks that a school that serves children for free would look that magnificent.
Even people ask me that question. Why do you want to go to that God-forsaken village and build such a majestic building? Mm-hmm. I said, it is not me. I am not building. He wants his schools to look like palaces.
Give us a couple of more examples of how he's been guiding you.
I will tell you, you asked me about last fortnight, last week, what he said.
Yeah.
When I was in Gulbarga last time, I returned here on 21st December. And 17th December, Swami told me, you have to go to a place called Sindagi in Bijapur district.
Had you ever heard of that place before?
I had heard, because a lot of students from there study in Mudanahalli.
Okay.
You have to go there, just call a meeting of devotees and announce that Baba has decided to start a school here. If you find the land and give it to us.
If the community finds the land.
Yeah, community finds the land. So I just went there and announced and came back. And they're looking for the land seriously.
See, so that is the other side. Right. Yes. So far they haven't found it.
No, they will find. Because once Baba wills, it is going to happen.
Amazing.
It so happened in the case of Mandya also, where Baba had declared that he would come as Prem Sai. There also we found the land in a very miraculous way. And Bhumi Puja, or groundbreaking ceremony, was done.
Has he told you when Prem Sai is going to be born?
I think time will come when all this can be spoken about in public.
And how can this be authenticated? Will he tell you or somebody like he's been guiding to authenticate that it is the true Prem Sai?
Yeah. No, he has said that Prem Sai would come, and he has told me a few more things which are not for public at this point of time.
If I wait 5 minutes,
maybe
share.
I don't know. whenever he wants me to declare it, I will declare it to the world.
Okay.
Yes.
Remember, I'm a journalist, so I'd like to know.
My pleasure. Yes.
Well, these are amazing. I asked for two examples and you gave me two wonderful examples right off the top of your head. So, needless to say, you must not fear anything.
I don't fear anything because he is always with me. I know that he is with me. That feeling was there even earlier. And now it is more, strong. Because, it's such a, matter of fact. Because he asked me to announce three things. And announced three things which I did not believe myself. And all that happened. So now I have to believe.
You and I shared something in common. As we said, we were both doubting Thomases at one time.
Yeah.
And I know that Baba is calling people to his side now, people who have never heard his name before, been to Prashanti before, seen his form before while he was alive, but they're being called now. Some of these people are a little bit confused yet. They're not quite sure what they're supposed to believe. They may also be doubting Thomases. What can you say to those people?
See, the thing is this, God always existed. See, when you say that you pray to Jesus Christ, you believe that he exists today, otherwise why will you pray to him?
Yeah.
Though he left his body 2000 years ago, you believe that he exists. The fact is he exists and he guides you. Mm-hmm. When I pray to Sri Rama, who lived some thousands of years ago, I believe that he exists today. Because we believe Satya Sai Baba is God, just because he has shed his mortal coil, it doesn't mean he has vanished. He is always there. He was always there. And whoever believes that he is there, I am sure that they will get his guidance. They have to believe. Seek, seek, you shall get it. Knock, the door shall be opened to you. It was true 2000 years ago, true today, and true for all times. So therefore, the guidance is, it is basically faith and a sincere prayer from the heart. Lord, you exist. I know you exist. But why is it that you are not manifesting for me? Why is it that you are not guiding me? You cry like a child. I am sure that you are going to get guidance. That is the eternal law. That's what Jesus meant when he said, seek, you shall get it. So whoever sought was never disappointed. This is the experience of all people, all believers. If it is Jesus Christ, Sri Rama, Krishna, Buddha, doesn't matter. Whoever it is the same God. And he is going to respond. For all those people who get this kind of doubts, say, I am called to Baba. Baba is physically not there. What will happen? You pray to him sincerely. And you are bound to get guidance, sustenance, everything. And most importantly, what is the purpose of our life? The purpose of our life is, I have to realize I am God. God is not separate from me. Everybody has to realize that. That is where Baba is leading everybody to. That is the destination. He said it when he was in the physical body. Even today he is doing it.
And the very last part of this program, it's not a question for me. You've answered all my questions. It's a closing comment from you. What is it that you would like people to keep in the forefront of their consciousness as they make their journey along their Sai path?
Yeah. I would here like to quote Brother Lawrence.
Brother Lawrence.
Yes. Practicing the presence of God. What prevents us from knowing that God is with me this moment? It is my own ego, my own desires, my own attachments, right?
Exactly.
So once
or
you know,
my own anger, my own fear.
All that is ego. See, all that emerges from the ego.
Mm-hmm.
Once you set it aside, keep it aside, definitely God is with you. Feel the presence. Therefore, you want to be happy all the time. You should feel his presence all the time. There is no other way you can be happy all the time. See, with us human beings, what happens? We are happy when we are successful and we are miserable when we fail. All right? But there is one reason why you should be happy always and why you should be optimistic always is God is always with me. That is one and the only reason for which I have to be happy. If I know that God is with me always, I will be always happy and I will be always optimistic. It is just that and nothing else. So it is not only for the devotees of Baba. Anybody who is born in this world, if he or she has to be happy, they have to believe in God who is with them all the time.
So you don't have to move a mountain or change the world. All you have to do is change.
Change yourself. Yes. If you change yourself, the world will change for you.
Mr. Murthy, thank you very,
thank you.
Very much.
Thank
it's
you.
Been a wonderful, Sairam wonderful
Sairam.
Sairam.
Sairam. Nice. Possible because I am now 70 and you know he gives the energy, otherwise how could I do